Cyber Runners Cipher 02. Is it a newsletter or something? Laser weapons permanently do 5% more critical damage. Oh, I just got a bonus. Oh, it's like a skill book. Only I couldn't read it.
Don't mind me. Just a weary man, resting his feet. I help out Henrik from time to time. Not very often these days. But that's fine.
What do you do here?
Oh, Henrik is an old friend of mine. I help out around here from time to time. But I don't just loiter around. I'm involved in my own business endeavor as well.
Oh, yeah? Maybe I do business with you.
Unfortunately, I'm quite old-fashioned. I only deal with associates that I know and trust. Hmm. But if you do a small favor for me, I might feel comfortable opening my business up to you. All you need to do is pick up a package from Red Mile and deliver it to me. You don't even need to interact with anyone.
Red Mile. What's in the package?
The contents are of no interest to you.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're not contraband, if that's what you're wondering. If you're uncomfortable doing this favor, you're free to decline.
I know that. What even is your business?
I'm not at liberty to discuss that yet. But I assure you, it's quite lucrative.
Well, I don't know if I even want to do business with him. I don't even know what he sells. But my interest has peaked a little, I guess, so sure, I'll do it.
Fantastic. I eagerly await your return.
Yeah, don't be too eager. Probably took me a while to get there. Slow day in here, isn't it?
Maybe a little, but that's not such a bad thing, is it? Better than all the noise and attention topside, if you ask me.
Hmm. So it's more run down, but more chill down here, I guess.
Stay out of trouble.
Vincente Salinas told me if I pick up a package from Red Mile, he'll do business with me. And this one, Guillaume asked me to get his ship back, or his gem back, from George St. George. Hopefully this plate is enough for George to make the exchange. I've delivered Nissa's cargo. Hopefully now she can complete her recipe. So what is this plate? Oh, there's that thing. The Megacore have met their match. Wealth redistribution made easy. Still want to read it. Old Earth Plate. Huh. That's it, huh? Locked.
No lawyering, okay? I don't have the patience for it.
I'm talking to you.
Can't say I'll have what you need, but you're welcome to look.
I'm surprised to find an electronics shop in the well.
That's so. I think folks down here are too poor to afford electronics. Not the first time I heard that line.
That's not what I said, exactly.
Yeah, I get that kind of attitude far too often. You find yourself with any more commentary, feel free to keep it to yourself.
Oh, boy. Sorry, I didn't mean anything by it.
It's fine. Just maybe give things an extra thought before you let them roll right out of your mouth.
Hmm. So I guess I shouldn't say that either, then. What do you have for sale?
You see something you like, just say the word.
It's got miscellaneous. Digipicks. I'll take those. Circuit boards. Positron battery. I'll have to remember to come back here if I need any electronic resources.
Stop by anytime.
Yeah. As long as I don't say the wrong thing. Got a little touchy, huh? I don't know where I am, other than somewhere in the well. What showed up? A switch? Well, that closes on it. Someone was planning on drinking and making notes. Wow. All hail our benevolent overlords. I thought he was someone special. Medical?
I've got limited resources. I try not to turn anyone away just because they're lighting credits. We're doing the best we can here. That's all we can ever do.
Well, what can you do?
Maybe don't say this. The last one didn't like it that much. You run this place all by yourself?
Don't have much of a choice. Can't afford to pay staff, and while I've got a few volunteers from the community, I can only ask so much of them.
Hmm.
We've scraped by for a good long while now, and we'll continue to do so. Don't you worry.
Okay. I could use some medical supplies.
We're no Reliant Medical down here, but if you've got credits, I might have something for you.
Adacrone. Suppresses addiction symptoms for 10 minutes. Used to fight symptoms or withdrawal until a cure can be administered. Huh. Heal paste. Treats burns and frostbite. Take one of them. Junk flush. Cures all addictions. Wow. If only we had something like that, right? In the real world. Penicillin X. A high-intensity antibiotic designed to purge the body of infection, used for treating afflictions. For infections, okay. You never know what's gonna happen to me out there. I need help?
Okay. What seems to be the problem? You look to be in fine shape. No help needed.
Alright, just checking. Oxygen tanks. Operating room. Pharmaceutical kit. How you doing? Have you tried the chamomile tea? I thought she was following you. It looks like she's just passing through. Pharmaceutical lab? I can craft this stuff. Snake oil. Used to purge the body of toxins, initially developed as a hangover preventative. That's interesting. I was just gonna craft some stuff.
Best watch your pockets around me. Just saying.
Were you gonna steal stuff?
If you got anything valuable on you, keep it close. Never know what might happen down here.
What do you do down here? Steal stuff?
Why do you want to know? You with security?
Sounds like you've got something to hide.
Oh yeah? Maybe I'll hide my boot in your ass if you don't quit asking questions.
Oh, big man.
That is, unless you're with security. In which case, I wasn't threatening you, that was just a joke. No crime's been committed.
Oh my.
I'm actually a very nice person.
Uh-huh. Anything interesting going on?
Are you kidding? Take a look around. You're in the most boring place in the galaxy. Only good thing down here is Kay's house. Best cooking in the settled systems. And let me tell you, I know my food. But I can't even go there anymore because Kay banned me for bad behavior. Me? Can you believe that? What a load of crap!
I don't think all you have is bad behavior.
Oh, are we still talking?
Nope. Oh, that's the electronics, okay.
Something's just gotten so bad. Maybe if I try easy.
House of the Enlightened. What is this place?
Well, they say never hire a man when a machine can do it for free. But down here, people can't afford the machine.
Tell that to the electronics place.
Kay's food is as close to home cooking as you'll find around here.
What's it like living in the well?
What you see is what you get. Work's rough, pay's rougher. But I like to think when things get bad, that's when people's kindness shines brightest. Even down here, where the sun don't shine.
Did you grow up here?
No, I came here like a lot of folks, looking for work. It's an ongoing search. Ones who've been here for a while, they can't even sleep unless they got a turbine in their ear. Maybe someday I'll be the same.
All right, any other advice?
Nope, just make sure you wipe your feet. You track mud in, then someone's got to sweep it out.
Someone like you.
Most days, that's me.
All right.
Stay safe.
We run a number of social programs, from financial aid to food banks.
Oh, yeah?
There's a lot of work that needs to be done in the well. A lot of people in need.
What is the House of Enlightenment?
We started as an intellectual movement built around atheism.
Oh.
As our numbers increased, we began focusing on humanitarian efforts and showing what humanity can achieve when we work together.
So funny. House of Enlightenment, though. You wouldn't think they were atheists. Who pays for all this?
We don't exactly pass around an offering plate, if that's what you're asking. But we do run mostly on donations. And as you might have guessed from the surroundings, we try and stretch those donations as far as we can.
Well, I might be looking for work. I don't know what kind of work they'd have.
Perfect. It just so happens there's a task I need help with right now.
Huh. Raised universal, yeah. Almost as if God ordained it. I thought they were atheists.
Very funny. Not exactly proof of a higher creator, but if you do well, maybe I won't argue the point. As for the job, I need you to pick up a man named Tahir over at the MedBay.
Oh, it's just there.
He's recovering from some injuries and needs assistance getting back to his apartment.
Okay.
I'd like you to pick him up, grab a bite to eat, and take him home.
I gotta take him out to dinner, too? Is he unable to walk home by himself?
I'm afraid not. Even after you're healed, it takes time to recover from something like this.
From what?
Most people have family and friends to lean on, but Tahir has no one. On top of that, he's a young and prideful man, so he won't accept help from UC security.
Hmm. Why is the UC helping him? I mean, I guess he won't accept their help.
That's a touchy subject. Tahir's had several run-ins with UC security, including tagging, theft, and brawls.
Tagging.
He also blames the UC for the conditions in the well, not to mention his own personal difficulties. And since he won't accept help from the authorities, the house is stepping in to provide some aid.
Where does Tahir live?
In one of the poorer districts, near where the children play soccer. Take him that far and he should be fine. Tahir is prideful, and I don't want him to feel like you held his hand. You just nudged him in the right direction.
Isn't this one of the poorer districts? Sure, I'll do the job.
Great. You'll find him over at the MedBay. He's probably hungry, so after you pick him up, escort him over to Kay's. She should have a meal ready for him to take home. And thanks.
2,000 credits. I'm loving it. What's down here?
Kay's place is like a second home. Problem is, I don't really have a first.
Got it. What's all this? Don't forget to meet Claire. The fighting may have ended, but many hearts are still waging war. Interview Thursday 0900, day since last incident 3. I'm trying to read this stuff. Actual dimensions. Looks like they're trying to put shelves together. Gimple box. Oops. Oh! I need those. Pardon me. You're really in the way. Can you come out? Let me look at these lockers. He's not coming out of there. The fighting may have ended, but many hearts are still waging war.
They say they don't need a programmer on board, but their shipboard system literally uses quantum synergy software to talk to the hardware. Yeah. What if that malfunctions?
You're hearing that through the vent.
You don't say.
Our colony war support groups are free and confidential.
How are things going?
Contact SSCOM 3010. Help us here today. I find the peace you fought for. Bad morale, good morale. Lay off the booze. This is... There's no water down here. This is locked. Place is flooded out. You finally got out of there. Thank you. Thank you. gotta read these. If I don't get stolen, I mean if I don't get caught. I was just gonna pick them up, but I guess I could read them. Jake and the Inu, A Tale of Enlightenment, Part 1. Since he was a boy, Jake's family has protected the Inu, the ancient creatures who brought life to his mountain. Each day, Jake would enter their cave and clean the stone statues that connected the Inu to this world. He kept their location secret and shielded the Inu from the greedy men who lived in the valley of the mountain. Jake was always kind to his wife and sons so that he could tell the Inu of his good deeds. The Inu rewarded Jake's devotion by bringing his family the life-giving stream. Each spring it would flow from the mouth of their cave and bless his fields with a bountiful harvest. This blessing had only grown stronger each year. Jake's farmland was so prosperous that it covered the mountain and was seen by those in the valley. One day, two men visited Jake's farm. "Let us buy your grains and your fruits," they said, "for none will grow beyond the mountain." But Jake turned them away. "The valley has run dry, and surely you can make do with less." But the men's coins were of no use to Jake, for he received all that he needed from the Inu. One night, Jake woke to sounds coming from the Inu's cave. He raced to the entrance, only to find the cave filled with men from the valley. Each one held an Inu statue and was carrying it down from the mountain. Jake cried for them to stop, but one man held him at the mouth of the cave. "The lands of the valley are dying," he said. "These spirits can bring us water, but you have kept them all to yourself. We will leave what you have already grown, but we are taking the Inu to the valley." Oh. Part 2. Jake cursed and pleaded with the thieves, but it was no use. Soon every Inu was removed from the cave. Jake wept. What would become of the mountain? He continued visiting the cave each day. He cleaned the floors where the Inu had stood and recited his good deeds to the walls. Jake dreaded the spring. Without the gift of the Inu stream, what would become of the fields? Then in the spring, the stream flowed from the cave anyway. Jake was confused, but his family wasted no time. They cultivated their fields, and that summer they saw their most bountiful harvest in years. The following spring, the stream appeared again. Jake began to wonder, were more Inu hiding in the cave? He waded into the stream and traveled beyond the Inu's cavern, much further than he had before. But instead of more Inu, Jake found a large underground lake. He also found tunnels bringing fresh water into the cave from the rainy side of the mountain. Later that day, Jake traveled down to the village in the valley. He found its people desperate and their lands parched. Jake visited the farms of the village. He found an Inu statue placed in each tree, but he could see that the rocky, dry land would never grow fruit. That evening, Jake returned to his wife and shared what he had seen. They spent all night looking down on the valley. In the morning, they called for their sons, and the family harvested their fields. They packed half of all they had grown in large wooden carts. The next day, Jake stood at the mouth of the Inu's cave. He turned and joined his family as they traveled down the mountain. Charity in a Godless Universe. I've looked at some of these. I guess we're gonna just read for a little bit. Charity in a Godless Universe, Amelia Tseng, Part 1. Atheism was the first step for me. I was raised in a world of right and wrong. I walked among chosen people. Each night my family would gather and pray for the sinners in our lives to find salvation. I can't tell you exactly when I stopped believing in these things. Like many who lose their faith, for me the cracks form slowly over time. An illogical verse here, an unanswered question there. One day you realize you're working hard to hold on to something false. You don't want to lose your community or your connection to your family, but sometimes maybe things that don't make sense are just wrong. The details of my awakening aren't important, but what came next is. I never expected that losing my faith would begin a profound new chapter in my life, a time of deep compassion and charity as a member of the Enlightened. Part 2. My settlement was founded as a commune by the members of my family's church, a place where the congregation could worship in peace without interference. But word travels fast, and our small colony began to grow. Our success attracted those in need of help and those with nowhere else to turn. When I was 10 years old, I watched two officers lead a frail-looking man down our street. He had been stealing from our settlement's emergency rations. Our local security had been trying to catch the thief for weeks. I asked my parents if the man was hungry. If he didn't have enough to eat, couldn't we feed him the same food he had been stealing? My parents explained that while our settlement probably could afford to feed the man, stealing is a sin and the thief must ask God for forgiveness. That night, my family gathered to pray for the soul of the man. They asked God to help him see beyond a life of sin. That man's name was Edgar, and he didn't need our prayers. Edgar needed food and work. Since no one gave him either, Edgar would be in and out of our settlement's prison for several years to come. Part 3. When I was 19 years old, my church decided it was time to leave. The announcement was filled with phrases like fresh start and renewal. Apparently, our settlement had taken in too many non-believers. The congregation would pack up and build a new colony on a distant world, a place without outsiders, where their faith could become the law. Cowards, you're running away. I begged my family not to leave. These people came here for our help. If we take their generators, how will the rest of the colony survive? To most of my community, these arguments made no difference. They could only see the outsiders as outsiders, non-believers, who are preventing them from living a pure life. These people have been coming here since you were a little girl, my father told me one night. They've had nearly 20 years to hear the word of God, but that's not what they want. We will leave them to their lives, and they should leave us to ours. Word quickly traveled through the poor parts of the settlement. As the departure date neared, the other colonists became desperate. Protests were common outside of the church buildings and outside of our starport, where a large ark-like ship was being constructed. Finally, on departure day, dozens of colonists gathered at the entrance to the starport. They blocked the church from entering, 100 gaunt faces against 100 blue robes. But the group was no match for the church's security forces. That team cleared a path, and the congregation boarded their ark. The crowd could only watch as a ship roared to life and then vanished into the sky. I stood in that crowd, watching as well. I could not bring myself to leave. Any faith which abandons the helpless was a faith I could not believe in. A loving God who inspired such cruelty must not be real. I would stay behind for whatever came next. Check to make sure no one walking in. Part 4. Of the 5 generators that once powered our settlement, my family's church had left behind just one. But with no one left with the knowledge to repair it, blackouts were frequent. 9 months after the church members left, conditions in our settlement were dire. Most of the colony's credits had left with the congregation, and merchants no longer had a reason to visit. We began rationing our remaining food, but supplies were running low. Anyone with the means to escape had long since left the planet. We faced a total collapse, if not for what happened next. The first ship arrived at night and woke up the whole settlement. No one had visited in months. In the dark, dozens of us made our way to the starport and found new craft landed there, large but older. On its side was painted a golden symbol, 6 hands joined around a planet. "Hello," yelled a man from a boarding ramp. "I'm Dr. Dewan. My friends and I are from the Enlightened. We heard there may be a settlement out here, in trouble." I pushed to the front of the crowd. "Our generators failed. We have about a week of recycled water left. Do you have anyone who can fix it?" "Okay," he said. "We can hook up your recycler to pull power from our ship. Then we can see about those repairs." "Hey," someone yelled from the crowd. "Are you people from some kind of church?" The man stopped and laughed. "No," he shouted back. "We're actually kind of the opposite." Over the next few days, more Enlightened ships arrived. Their crews fed us and restored our settlement's power. But then they didn't leave. Through Dr. Dewan, we learned more about the Enlightened. They call themselves atheist humanists. He told us that they go to places in the galaxy where people need help. "Without gods," he said, "all we have is each other." The Enlightened took up residence on the grounds of the old church and began teaching us survival skills, how to cook and how to repair our colony's equipment. They lent us credits to buy supplies, and within half a year, our settlement was functioning independently. Eventually, the Enlightened packed up and left our colonies to survive on its own, but this time I left too, as the newest member of their group. I had finally found a cause that made sense to me, an ethos I could believe in without ignoring part of myself. There are no gods to worship. No divine beings are coming to save us. Humanity's capacity for empathy and our willingness to support each other is our species' best hope to survive among the stars. It's up to mankind to watch over itself. Interesting. Nicholas Nickleby. Chapter 1. Did I read this? There once lived in a sequestered part of the country of Devonshire one Mr. Godfrey Nickleby, a worthy gentleman who, taking it into his head rather late in life that he must get married, and not being young enough or rich enough to aspire to the hand of a lady of fortune, had wedded an old flame out of mere attachment, who in her turn had taken him for the same reason. Thus two people cannot afford to play cards for money, sometimes sit down to a quiet game for love. Charles Dickens's third novel is a tale of a young man who struggles to support his family after his father inadvertently plunges them all into poverty, then dies. Pretty harsh. I know I read Oliver Twist. Simpler times. The foreword to a non-fictional account of life in New Homestead collected from residents over the years, originally published in 2324. Alright, so just 301 years, guys. We'll be able to read this in real life. If anyone tells you, like the title of this book, that life back in the early colonies could be described as simpler times, they are full of it. The title, thusly, is a repudiation of the idea. You'll see the claims in various forms of media, brochures, and other corporatized devices that life was somehow simpler than we have it today. The portrayals in such series as the old family-friendly show Hab on the Ice, for instance, paint an idealized perspective of New Homestead that couldn't be farther from the truth. Life was never simple here. The people you're about to hear from, some dating back to the mid-2100s, provide a unique insider view into what it was really like on Titan. You'll read about their struggles in the New Frontier era, as well as more current accounts of what it's like to preserve that veneer while dealing with a galaxy that has moved on. Forward by Amalia Sijed. Something like that. The Comet. While W.E.B. Du Bois is famous as a writer, civil rights activist, and sociologist, among other things, it is not widely known that he also penned a science fiction short story. The following is an excerpt from The Comet, written in 1920. Low on the horizon lay a long white star, mystic, wonderful, and from it fled upward to the pole, like some wan bridal veil, a pale wide sheet of flame that lighted all the world and dimmed the stars. In fascinating silence, the man gazed at the heavens and dropped his rockets to the floor. Memories of memories stirred to life in the dead recesses of his mind. The shackles seemed to rattle and fall from his soul. Up from the crash and crushing and cringing of his caste leaped the lone majesty of kings long dead. He arose within the shadows, tall, straight, and stern, with power in his eyes and ghostly scepters hovering to his grasp. Huh. Interesting. Great Expectations. Chapter 1. My father's family name being Perp, and my Christian name Philip, my infant tongue could make of both names nothing longer or more explicit than Pip. So, I call myself Pip, and came to be called Pip. Not the same thing that Pip in South Park says at some point. Charles Dickens' 13th novel is the coming-of-age tale of an orphan boy named Pip as he navigates the agendas of those around him, like the eccentric Miss Havisham. Crimson Cabin. 2301 finally saw the release of Crimson Cabin, Paul Lamont's long-awaited sequel to the hit novel The Fruit Seller. Like his previous works, it sold in the millions throughout the settled systems. Freedom. Savory, delicious freedom. The hag smiled as she peered up at the open trap door. She slithered rather than climbed her way up the narrow, rickety staircase. In seconds, she emerged from the fruit cellar into the cabin proper. Someone, some unknown ally to the dark, had broken the arcane seals that had been put in place years before. Sunlight, glaring and harsh, poured in through the open front door. "And now," hissed the hag, "I will leave this cabin behind and visit my beloved Vermont once more." Pretty cool book collection. Oh. The orchid merchant. "I love you," said the orchid merchant. "And I love you, my dearest," said Vincenza in return. "But our passion, how long can it last? For our families will never approve of our union. "Perhaps not, my dearest Vincenza, perhaps not," he said, pushing an orchid into her lovely black hair, "but we don't need them anyway." The Orchid Merchant, written by Carlita Carr and published in 2325, has become one of the fastest-selling romance novels in settled systems history. Well, I think that's it. Got some nice books back there. Well, here's the security office where you were.
I think I got them. What do you call them? Coins. Yeah, I got coins.
Congratulations. Yeah, I've never gotten those, but they can be rather painful. There's Kay's house. I'm gonna check this place out. We're gonna check it next episode, guys. But yeah, I wanna check this place out before we bring this guy here. Because I wanna go around and talk to everybody and I don't want him interfering. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time. And always, seek adventure.